someone to remind me to wear sunscreen and take my vitamins when it slips my mind. I want someone who knows how I like my coffee and wants to share a bed for more than a night. But I'm stubborn, selfish, easily jealous at times. I'm hard to love, and I just want someone to try. I want someone who knows that I'm not made for mornings and doesn't scold me for smoking when I drink. I want someone who listens when they've heard the story and gives me enough space to breathe. 'Cause I'm stubborn, selfish, and easily jealous at times. I'm hard to love, and I just want someone to try. To try. Stubborn, selfish, easily jealous would be fine. I won't mind if they're hard to love. I just want someone to try.
Sus, we love you so, so much.
Yes. Oh, so much.
We love you this big!
Sam, I'm so happy for you on your wedding day. It's so nice to be able to be part here and part of it. You are an amazing young man, and I'm excited to see where this adventure of marriage takes you. And thank you for letting us be part of your day.
Your turn.
Sam, I'm happy to be a part of this. I'm glad you asked me. Can't wait to see where this takes you, and good luck.
Yeah.
Suzu, I am so, so happy for you and Sam. I was thinking about seeing you and Sam are together and when me and Luke were together at that same point before we got married. And I can tell you guys are just best friends, and I know that that's gonna do wonders. You're gonna be so much more in love than you ever have been before. And I am so, so happy for you guys. So, I don't know what else to say.
Dearest Susanna, we've grown up together, and we started playing dress-ups in your mom's closet, and we kept doing that and followed each other through life, and now we're doing it one more time, but this time's for real. I love you. Have so much fun, and I can't wait for the next set of adventures.
Susanna, I haven't known you very long, but I have loved you for so, so long in that time. That doesn't make any sense, but it's coming from me, so you understand. I wish you and Sam so much happiness, and I hope you have so much fun together. I love you.
Susanna, I loved you since the moment you barged into my room freshman year and said that we were going to be friends. And here we are on your wedding day, and you look so beautiful. And I'm so excited for you and Sam for this next chapter of your life. And we will definitely keep in touch. Maybe we need a new name other than Lisu's. You've got to be Susanna. There we go. That's the one.
3, 2, 1.
We love you, Sam. And you should shave your beard.
You definitely should shave the beard.
Yeah.
100%. Yeah. 100%.
Save.
Our wish for you is for a lifetime of love, happiness, and joy.
And I agree. And like I said last night, I am so thankful to have Suze in our family and for Sam to start this new, wonderful, awesome phase of his life, of marriage and a life of friendship with Suze.
Amen. You ready? It rained so hard the day I left. The weather, it was fine. The sun's so hot, I froze myself. Susanna, don't you cry. So we're freezing ourselves here because we love you. This is your day. We are thrilled with your choice. We love you so much. And what a blast to have you find a wonderful partner for life. So, oh, Susanna, don't you cry for me. We'll see who wins today. If you cry more, I cry more. Dad cries more. I think he's going to be the winner. You want to say something, Pops?
Just so proud of you, honey. And just so looking forward to this day and all that's coming afterwards. So
yeah.
We love you so much.
And we're so excited to expand our family. You are right. Sam is a great addition. And I know you'll always be a soul at heart. Anyways, we love you. Bye.
Bye.
Dearly beloved, we've gathered in the sight of God to witness and bless the joining together of this man and this woman in holy matrimony. The bond and covenant of marriage was instituted by God in creation before we had fallen into sin and death, as a sign of the mystical union between Christ and the church. Our Lord Jesus Christ adorned and beautified this manner of life with his presence and first miracle at the wedding in Cana. And St. Paul commended marriage as a union to be honored by all, and therefore not to be entered into unadvisedly, lightly, or wantonly, to satisfy carnal lust and appetites, but reverently, deliberately, soberly, and in the holy fear of God, duly considering the purposes for which God created marriage. Three, marriages first are created and ordained by God for the mutual companionship, help, comfort, and joy that the one person ought to have of the other, both in prosperity and adversity. Second, God created marriage for our own growth, our sanctification, that as members of Christ's body, those joined in marriage might be made holy in their union by the power of the Holy Spirit. And finally, God created marriage for the procreation of children, to be brought up in the fear and nurture of the Lord and to the praise of his holy name. So into this holy union, Samuel Castile and Susanna Sewell now come to be joined. Therefore, if anyone can show cause why they may not be lawfully married, speak now or else forever hold your peace. Sam, if you'll stand next to Ms. Sewell. Sam and Susanna, I require and charge you both, as you will answer before God on the day of judgment, when the secrets of all hearts will be disclosed, that if either of you knows any impediment why you may not be married lawfully, you must now confess it, being assured that those who are joined contrary to God's word are not truly married. Samuel, I've got a very serious question for you. Will you have this woman to be your wife, to live together out of reverence for Christ in the covenant of holy matrimony? Will you love her, honor her, comfort and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, will you be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
God's help, I will.
Susanna, will you have this man to be your husband, to live together out of reverence for Christ in the covenant of holy matrimony? Will you honor him, love him, comfort him, keep him in sickness and in health, and will you forsake all others and be faithful to him as long as you both shall live?
With God's help, I will.
Now, congregation, I'm going to ask you a very important question. Will all of you witnessing these promises do everything in your power to uphold these two persons in their marriage? And now, Mom and Dad, who blesses this woman in union to this man?
Her mother and I.
All right. Thank you. Now, Sam and Susanna, if you'll come just up here. You may be seated.
Passionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, with thankfulness to your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father through him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. And in the house, the disciples asked again about this matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. They were bringing children to him that he might bless them. And the disciples rebuked the children. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. When there's a frame around the story, and that means you should interpret the entire story through that frame. A wedding is the frame, it's the lens, it's the interpretive key to the Bible. This binary of male and female is not simply an accidental evolutionary genetic quirk. It's right there in the beginning. It's part of the drama. In fact, as we read and reread this extraordinary account in Genesis chapter 1, we see that these complementary pairs, they all reinforce one another. They're pairs that are meant to work together. So that ultimately, the man and the woman coming together are a symbol of something that is the key to the story the Bible tells. They are the symbol of something that is true of creation as a whole. In Genesis 1, and then again in Genesis 2, man and woman are different, but they are complementary. They're designed to go together, to work together. And this climaxes at the end of Genesis 2 with the marriage of man and woman. And so when you jump all the way past all those other bits of the Bible and you land at the very end of the Bible, you find that the last two chapters of the Bible mirror the first two chapters of the Bible. The Bible ends with a marriage. The marriage of something that is the only pair that doesn't get pronounced good in chapter 1. If you read Genesis chapter 1, as it's going through, God's creating stuff and he says that it's good. And in every day he says it's good except one day. The only day when God doesn't pronounce goodness is when he creates heaven and earth. And that's the engine room that drives the drama of the entire Bible. What is not yet good about this pair? And then you get to the end of the Bible, and you discover at the very end of the Bible that the Bible ends with heaven and earth wedding together. The marriage of heaven and earth. The Bible ends in the marriage of heaven and earth. And that's quite a bit different from the kind of view of reality that many people here in the West for the past several centuries have been captured by. You see, we've been captured, some of us here lately, with the image that this whole thing ends with humans leaving Earth, landing in heaven, and Earth being destroyed, which is about as far as you can get from the story the Bible tells as is possible to get. To be sure, there is much about Earth in its present moment, which is sad and dark and gloomy and evil, that we want to be rid of. But the whole point of the narrative, the story the Bible tells, this grand story, is that God made heaven and earth as complementary pairs, and just like he brings man and woman together in a wedding, he is going to wed heaven and earth. And when that happens, when heaven comes to earth, all of earth will be renewed. All of earth will light up as the glory of God covers the earth like water covers the sea. The end of the story the Bible tells is not heaven floating out there with Casper and some convention for ghosts in the sky. The end of the story the Bible tells is the wedding of heaven and earth together, where earth is renewed and heaven and earth dwell together as we long for Sam and Susanna to dwell together, as their marriage this morning is pointing to. Now, all of this sounds quite esoteric and highfalutin. What I'm saying is that marriage is not simply a convenient social and sexual arrangement. It is tapping into the root issues of the universe, the fundamental fabric of what God is doing in the world. In Scripture, the coming together of one man and one woman is the first wedding in the Bible, and it points to the ultimate meaning of reality, which is the coming together of heaven and earth. This is God's intention. The intention of the Creator is to join heaven and earth in a single nuptial embrace. The purpose of God with this world is the marriage of heaven and earth, not their separation, but their fruitful combining. Now, it's this coming together of the complementary God-giving pairings that we celebrate in the marriage of a man and a woman, of this man and this woman, Sam and Susanna. So today, we're here because two lives, which up to now have been running in parallel, over the past year or so have been overlapping, but today these two lives are brought together. And at one level, this is an easy thing. But at another level, bringing together two lives is a huge and complex task fraught with all sorts of dangers and possibilities of misunderstandings. And so, of course, marriage is vulnerable to misunderstanding and manipulation. And for the next couple of minutes, I want to present two images, two metaphors, two pictures to help us understand marriage, to give Sam and Susanna away through the toxic landscape of marriage today in America. Two images. They're quite different from one another. The first one, quite lovely, the image of a garden. This is a great image to think about marriage because that's where the first marriage took place, right? Now, imagine a garden, a great garden. And imagine it on two levels. First of all, imagine the soil, rich garden soil. And it's the perfect soil for growing the perfect kind of plants. Now, I want you to also imagine in the midst of this garden with perfect soil, a beautiful tree growing out of this rich, wonderful soil. Now, think about this garden at those two levels, the soil and the tree growing out of it. One of these is your marriage. And one of these is your love. But which, the tree or the soil? Which is the marriage and which is the love? In our culture, the dominant view is that love is the soil that grows a marriage. A marriage grows out of love. This is the way our culture reads it today. The story of love, it's everywhere today. It's in our movies and magazines and books. It's the idea that meaning and value and hope and that you are incomplete until you can grow a marriage. That you're not a full human yet. And when you can find the right kind of love, you can grow the right kind of marriage. Think about the movie La La Land or The Notebook or even Shrek. They all tell the same story. They tell the story that romantic love is the strongest force in the universe. Find your soulmate and you'll be complete. Love will conquer all. It can help you chase your dreams, face all Alzheimer's, or even marry an ogre. And falling in love is like tapping into this force that overwhelms us, and it will empower you, like Zelda, to leap over mountains and to overcome every barrier we face. This force, this primal force of love in our society is greater and more powerful than any force on earth, so that story goes. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm obviously mocking that, but I'm not saying that romantic love is not powerful. It is. I'm not saying that it's bad. What I'm saying is that as powerful as love is, it is not powerful enough to build a marriage. Because everybody in this room knows marriages based on love that failed. It's not sufficient. When we look at romantic love as a foundation for a marriage, as capable of driving a marriage forward through gale force winds, the unfortunate and sad and well-documented reality is that when that happens, when your love is the foundation of your marriage, then your love becomes a boomerang for self-satisfaction, and I love you comes to mean you meet my needs, and that means you're going to ravage one another. You're going to destroy one another. That kind of marriage is destined for tragedy because it's really a form of self-idolatry. It says that the person I love exists to satisfy me, and so your marriage will dissolve into a cost-benefit analysis, and when that happens, your spouse will never be able to give you as much as you think you deserve. Now, romantic love is a gift. It is a gift from God. It is insufficient to build a marriage on. Whenever we do, whenever we try to build our marriages on romantic love, our marriages implode, and we get isolation and loneliness and self-absorption, and this world will doom you. So what I'm saying is that romantic love is not the soil. What's the soil? The soil is marriage, and romantic love is the fruit. Marriage is not the fruit of love. Love is the fruit of marriage. As counterintuitive as this may seem, the reality is that marriage is the soil. Our love for one another is the tree that grows in the bonds of vows and commitment and faithfulness and the structure and the discipline and the gift of marriage. In other words, we marry not only because we are in love, but in order to help love. So look at it this way. Your marriage is God's gift to you. It's God's gift to your love. Your love is beautiful. It's amazing. We're all drawn to it. We see you looking at it. We're here to celebrate it. And so God gives you a gift to sustain that. And the gift he gives you to sustain your love is marriage. If you put your marriage before your love, your marriage will fuel a beautiful love. And it will sustain, and enable your love to endure. If you don't get married, your love will not endure. It's doomed. It's over. If you give yourself to your marriage as your first priority, your love will make it through the cold winters ahead. But what does this actually look like? What does it actually mean to say that marriage is a soil and love is the fruit that can grow over a lifetime? Well, the best way I know is to shift to the second metaphor, a very different metaphor, a somewhat shocking metaphor. Instead of a garden, let's shift our mind to a grave. I think this is the other root metaphor of marriage, the grave. If we're going to think about marriage with the grain of the universe, then we need to understand the grave is the most helpful way forward. Let me show you what I mean. In Genesis chapter 2, the Lord calls Adam to fall into a deep sleep, which is a euphemism for death, still today in our culture. And while Adam is in this kind of metaphorical death, in that condition of a living death, the Lord took a rib and built a woman for Adam. And what this confronts us with, this is the primordial story of marriage, is that Adam is going to have a bride. And if he's going to, he must die first. Adam wants a bride. Adam, he's got to die. And then in the next chapter of Genesis, when the serpent came to tempt Eve, Adam was not off on the other side of the garden. The Bible is clear. He was right there beside her. And Adam faced a choice as the serpent slithered up. Either he would put himself between his bride and the beast, or he would stand back and leave Eve to her death. And then after the Lord came to confront Adam, he once again was faced with a choice. Either he would intercede for his wife or he would blame her. And both times, Adam's sin was his refusal to die for his bride. Sam and Susanna, a garden and a grave. You have to have both images to form a good and lasting marriage. Because not only do you need to put romance in its proper place, you need to put yourself in its proper place. Marriage is hard. And it's hard because it requires mutual surrender. It demands that both of you commit yourselves to the death of self and ambition in order to make lasting love possible. A husband and a wife do not constantly crucify Their own selfishness and self-sufficiency will crucify their marriage. It's not a question of will there be a crucifixion in your life. It's what's going to die. Remember that rascal Adam? He's a great example of a bad husband because he didn't learn the lesson of his wedding day. The lesson that marriage demands death. But the good news is that he's not the last Adam. He's not the last word. Because in God's great love for us, the one and true creator of all things, God the Father, sent Jesus the Son. And on the cross, Jesus Christ, the last Adam, went to death, actual death, a real deep sleep for the sake of his bride. And by doing this, Jesus transformed his bride, who was far from beautiful, into a beautiful bride, spotless and without wrinkle or blemish. And he did all of this, scripture tells us, for the joy set before him, for the joy of resurrection, for the joy of consummation, for the joy of consummation with his bride and the hope of resurrection. Sam and Susanna, you are entering into the covenant of Christian marriage. You are swearing in God's name to a level of devotion and sacrifice and self-giving that you have never attempted and has never been expected of you. And if you continue the habits, Sam, of a single man, Susanna, of a single woman, you will mock your marriage vows. God will hold you accountable, and your love will die. Your love is a tree of life that grows in the rich soil of the garden of marriage. So give yourself to your marriage. Nurture your marriage. Guard your marriage. Protect your marriage. Because without the practice and discipline of marriage, your love will be exhausted and fail. So Sam, you are promising in God's name that you will be faithful and loyal to Susanna like Jesus is faithful and loyal to the church. Faithfulness is the engine of marriage. It's the fuel of marriage. It's the heart of marriage, not romance. Romance is the bloom of marriage. The fruit of marriage nurtured in faithfulness. You're promising with an oath, Sam, to give your life for Susanna's sake. And Susanna, you are swearing in the name of the one true God to honor Sam with joy and respect. And Sam, you are called to be Adam. And Susanna, you are called to be Eve. And together you are called to make your marriage and your home a small restoration of Eden in the wastelands that we live in. And you can do this because you're Christians. At your baptism, our great Father poured out his Holy Spirit into your life. And you can draw down on his power. You can draw down on the Spirit's power. You can welcome the death that marriage brings to you because you follow a master who said, whoever wishes to save his life shall lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Sam and Susanna, what you are doing today is you're raising a flag. You're setting up a signpost. You're establishing a symbol in the midst of the world of creation, which points forward to the new creation. The God who made this world, he's not finished with it. And despite all the challenges and puzzles and problems you will face, as every day you walk out into the thicket of your promises, looking to clear a path forward through the mud, God is bringing heaven and earth together through the one in whom they are already joined together, Jesus Christ, and that is our hope and joy. So in the name of Jesus, and speaking for the church gathered here today and throughout the ages, to those being married, I command you to love one another as Christ loves us. And we pray that God will give you and us the power to fulfill such a command. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. And together, those of us who are Christians, let us confess the words of our own marriage vows to the Lord Jesus, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by
by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sam, take Susanna's right hand and both of yours and repeat after me, but to her, please, not to me. In the name of God, I, Samuel, take you, Susanna.
In the name of God, I, Samuel, take you, Susanna.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better or worse.
For better or worse.
For richer, for poorer.
Before,
in sickness and in health,
sickness and in health,
to love, cherish, and respect,
to love, cherish, and respect,
until we are parted by death alone,
until we are parted by death alone,
according to God's holy word,
according to God's holy word,
this is my solemn vow,
this is my solemn vow.
And Susanna, if you'll take Samuel's right hand and both of yours, repeat after me, in the name of God.
In the name of God.
I, Susanna, take you, Sam.
I, Susanna, take you, Sam.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
To love, cherish, and respect.
To love, cherish, and respect. Until we are parted by death alone.
Until we are parted by death alone.
According to God's holy word.
According to God's holy word.
This is my solemn vow.
This is my vow.
Now you brought signs, you brought rings as a sign of the covenant that you're entering into. A covenant by which you are bound to each other through Jesus Christ our Lord. Sam, hold this ring on Susanna's ring finger. Hold it there and repeat after me. Susanna, I give you this ring.
Susanna, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And with all that I am.
With all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Susanna, hold this ring. Place this on his ring finger and hold it there while you're repeating after me. Sam, I give you this ring.
Sam, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And with all that I am.
And with all that I am.
And all that I have.
All that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's pray. You can hold hands here. Eternal God, creator and preserver of all mankind, giver of all spiritual grace, the author of everlasting life, send your blessing upon these, your servants, this man and this woman, whom we bless in your name, that as Isaac and Rebecca lived faithfully together, so Sam and Susanna may surely perform and keep the vows and covenant made between them, and may forever remain in perfect love and peace together, and live according to your laws, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now that Sam and Susanna have entered into this holy covenant and made their vows to one another before God and these people, and have signified this covenant with the joining together of hands and the giving and receiving of rings, I pronounce that they are husband and wife. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, those whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Now let's stand and sing.
Wisdom and devotion in the ordering of their common life, that each may be to the other a partner in prayer, a strength in need, a counselor in perplexity, a comfort in sorrow, and a companion in joy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Grant that their wills may be so knit together in your will and their spirits in your spirit, that they may grow in love and devotion to you and to one another all the days of their lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give them courage when they hurt each other to recognize and acknowledge their faults, to seek your forgiveness, and to forgive and be reconciled to one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
May their union in holy matrimony be a sign of the love between Christ and his church, and a joyful witness in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Bestow upon them, if it be your will, the gift and heritage of children, and the grace to bring them up to know you, to love you, and to serve you.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Grant that they may so love honor and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give them such grace that together they may reach out in love and concern for others, and grant that all married persons who have witnessed these spouse may find their lives strengthened and their loyalties confirmed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Grant these our prayers, O Father, who with your Son and the Holy Spirit live and reign in perfect unity, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Most gracious God, we give you thanks for your tender love in sending Jesus Christ to come among us, to be born of a human mother, and to make the way of the cross to be the way of life. We thank you also for consecrating the union of man and woman in his name. By the power of your Holy Spirit, pour out the abundance of your blessing upon Sam and Susanna. Defend them, O Lord, from every enemy. Lead them into all peace. Let their love for each other be a seal upon their hearts, a mantle upon their shoulders, and a crown upon their foreheads. Bless them in their work and in their companionship, in their sleeping and in their waking, in their joys and in their sorrows, in their life and in their death. In your mercy, bring them to your heavenly banquet where your saints feast forever at the great marriage supper of the Lamb, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Sam and Susanna, if you'll come stand up here, face one another, Sam and Susanna. The peace of the Lord, you have a bit to say back to me, but the peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And also with you.
Sam, you may kiss the bride. Now you'll stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord.
Congratulations, Richard.
If you'll please have a seat as the wedding party comes back up front. So, as is quite obvious, this is a Christian wedding. There are many ways to do weddings. Sam and Susanna love our Lord. And so we're having a worship service, and Christians have always had a meal when they worship. You can't find a worship service in the Bible without a meal. And just like you've never been to a wedding without a party afterwards. If you were, you didn't want to go back. That was a good one. So now we have the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
If you'll stand now. Father, it is right, it is our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you. You are the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth. Because in the love of wife and husband, you have given us an image of the heavenly Jerusalem, adorned as a bride for her bridegroom, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who loves her and gave himself for her, that he might make the whole creation new. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, and who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Amen.
Thank you.
God, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy, you gave us your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. And he made there, by his one oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted, and in his holy gospel commanded, that we continue a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. Amen. Amen. On the night that our Lord was betrayed and handed over to suffering and death, he was having a meal with his disciples, and in that meal he took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And then he gave it to them, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you do this, do it in the remembrance of me." Then Scripture is very clear. After the meal, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them. He said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we're very bold to pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Just like at Christmas, when your father or your mother perhaps gave you gifts, these are gifts. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. I realize that there's a good chance probably not everybody here is a Christian. Like, our country is filled with a number of different religions. This is a Christian meal. There's some important instructions in your worship guide. If you're a Christian, if you are baptized, no matter what your stripe, Baptist, Methodist, Catholic, you're welcome. This is the Lord's table. Welcome to the Lord's feast. We're going to sing throughout this meal.
Whatever my life, thou hast taught me to say.
the giver of all that is true and lovely and gracious, we thank you for binding us together in these holy mysteries of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, for uniting us with him and giving us a foretaste of the great marriage supper of the Lamb. Father, grant that by your Holy Spirit, Sam and Susanna, now joined in holy matrimony, may become one in heart and soul, live in fidelity and peace, and obtain those eternal joys prepared for all who love you, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Now, if the wedding party will come back to your places, I will pronounce a blessing. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit bless you and preserve you and keep you. The Lord look mercifully with his favor upon you and fill all of you with all spiritual benediction and grace, so that all of us, so that Sam and Susanna may faithfully live this life and in the age to come have life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, Sam, if you'll, Susanna, if you'll turn, it is my privilege to introduce to you for the first time Mr. and Mrs. Samuel Castile. The congregation will stay.